Hello and welcome to this episode of In Conversation. Joining me on the program today is Dr. Narendra Yadav, Principal Economic Advisor to the RBI. He is author of Monetary Economics for India and Challenge to Indian Banking. Dr. Yadav was awarded the Maharashtra Sahitya Parishad Award in 1992 for his book, Dr. Ambedkar, Economic Thoughts and Philosophy. He is here today to talk about his latest book, Outcast, which is his memoir. Welcome to the program. It's a pleasure to have you here, and let me congratulate you on that really courageous and inspiring story.
Thank you.
Well, the statistics are really shocking. Around 165 million today, Dalits are almost three times the population of UK or France, and they're still trying to find self-expression after so many years, after having been denied their rights for so many years. So what does this say about our country and the many progresses that we say we've made?
Well, what it says about this country is that there is a large chunk of India's population which has been denied the basic human rights for a very long time. But this is the past. Things are changing now, and because of the social economic changes which have taken place over the last century and particularly in the last 50 years with people like Dr. Ambedkar at the helm, I think things are changing, and I feel that there is a silent revolution taking place, and this large part of the society which was once denied the basic human rights and which were denied the opportunities of education have got them now, and they have started speaking out. And what you see in terms of the literature is the story of these people. People did not even know what kind of life their own brethren were living just outside the village boundaries. People have come to know now, with so many Dalits, with universalization of education, so many Dalits coming forward and talking about their own life is making people realize what kind of society we are.
But you paint a very optimistic scenario. Yes. In urban centers, yes, but you find that in huge parts of rural areas, this caste discrimination and casteism is still vicious as ever. So we still have a long way to go, don't we?
Certainly, you know, we have a very long way to go, but I look at the positive part of it. I look at the change that has taken place. People like Dr. Ambedkar, at the time when Gandhiji was telling people to go to villages, Dr. Ambedkar said the opposite. He told people to go from villages to cities. Cities, they could buy untouchable, you know, they could become touchable in city, they could be part of the bigger society. They got the opportunity, they got education, they got opportunities. And today, over the last 50 years, the kind of change that is taking place, I think, is nothing short of a silent revolution. Today, you will find that in every walk of life, from painting, drawing, to sculptures, to neurosurgery, in every walk of life, you will find some Dalit boy or girl trying to find a place for himself or herself. Now, this is a social revolution. And I think this augurs very well for the future. True, a lot remains to be done. But I don't think we can ignore the kind of thing that is happening right before us. And it is a silent revolution.
But even among the outcasts, as you say in your book, even among the outcasts, there are outcasts.
Yes,
so this,
of course.
These efforts to sort of homogenize or make a sort of a broad Dalit identity, do you think it was doomed from the start? Because you find that there's a hierarchy system even among your community.
Very true. You see, it is such a mind-boggling design. I mean, one is shocked to see the kind of intricate mechanism and hierarchy which has been embedded and built over a period of time. There are caste within caste, and then there are sub-caste and sub-sub-caste, and their roles are very well defined, and their interrelationship is defined extraneously. But we are coming out of it, and I think with the kind of changes which are taking place in Indian economy and generally in the society, I think these barriers are breaking down. And I have been saying this, a lot of people don't agree with that, but I think the next step is with globalization. The caste barriers over a period of time are going to break. The kind of changes which are taking place, this process has begun. I'm not saying they are gone. I'm saying that it's very much there. In fact, today, I find that the discrimination is there even in cities. You seem to think that it's there in the villages but not in cities. No, it is there in the cities too. Only difference is that in cities, it has acquired a subtle form which is more dangerous.
Yeah. Because at least during the time of the independence, you had the social reform movement and there was this fight against the system.
Right.
But now you find that people seem to have really regressed.
No, not regressed, but you see, it's there in the deep down in their mindset that is not changing. So, you know, when I see somebody practicing caste-based manners or something, making assumption about yourself based on the caste, you know, I don't feel angry. I feel pity. I feel sympathetic to the person because he is suffering from a disease. He doesn't know about it. It's his mind. See, that's why. See, the conversion that took place in Maharashtra under Dr. Ambedkar's leadership is very important. The untouchability and the issue of caste system has two aspects. One is how others look at you and how you look at yourself. Others were looking down on us, and this was happening for so long a period of time that we ourselves were denigrating us and we were looking down on ourselves. Our confidence was gone, complexes were developed. I think Dr. Ambedkar changed one basic thing. He made them ask a very basic question. The question was, it may be in the interest of others to be your masters, but why should it be in your interest to be their slaves? Now, this was the question which was asked by people like my father, and that changed their mindset. Today, we have reached a stage where we say that we don't look down on us. If you are looking down on us, it's your problem. Problem is in your mindset, not in mine. This is the silent revolution I'm talking about.
Since you spoke about conversion,
right.
Do you think that Ambedkarji converting to Buddhism, the movement lost some of its sting? Because you say that, of course...
No, I don't think so.
Because a lot of people voluntarily followed his footsteps,
right,
and became,
right,
Buddhist.
Right.
Do you think there was an underlying sense of defeat?
No, it's not. In fact, if you look at the strategy that Dr. Ambedkar followed all along, from 1927, the year in which he entered in public life, to 1935, he tried to reform the Hindu religion from within. Look at his Saudarthala movement, look at his temple satyagraha in Nasik. All those were within the framework of Hinduism. He reached a stage after working for 12 years, he reached a stage where he realized that he is not going to be able to change the mindset of people. And therefore he said that we have to break out of that. To give ourselves an identity, we have to come out of it and have our own identity. So he, in 1935-36, he made the announcement that although I am a born Hindu, I am not going to die Hindu. This was in 1935-36 in Yevla. 20 years after that, and he was exploring different religions, he was also, among others, an authority on comparative religion. So he studied all the religions and finally came to a decision that he will go for Buddhism because it has the egalitarian mechanism in it. Now what happened was, he converted, and along with him, 500,000 people converted into Buddhism, which my father and mother included. This was a revolution because this is a Dhamma Chakra Pravartan, you know, a complete change. Nowhere in the history of world you will find another example of such mass conversion without using sword or without using money. On his words, we did. My parents did. This was on 14th October 1956. Within 50 days after that, Dr. Ambedkar passed away. Now what happened was, he gave us the religion, he gave us the identity, but before he could teach us how to behave in that religion, and before he could institutionalize the new structure, he passed away. On December 6, 1956, he passed away. Because of that, there was suddenly a gap. So what happened was, we embraced the religion, not because we understood it, not because we liked it, because he was our leader, we had faith in him, he led us there and we went there. After having gone there, then he himself passed away, unfortunately. So that created a vacuum. I don't think there is a sense of defeat. I think this has given them identity. And I'll give you a very simple example. Look at the names that Dalits in Maharashtra give to their children. Before 1956, look at the names. Dagdu, which means stone. Kachru, which means dirt. Yes. These are the names of people. Why? Because the typical Dalit would go to the village priest and ask him what the name should be given. Infant mortality rate was very high. So he will say, you give a name like that, Kachra, Kuda, you know, dirt, so that the God will not have the evil eye, will not cast a shadow, or something like that. You please see that after 1956, not a single Dagdu is born, not a single Kachru is born. Now Siddharths are born, Gautams are born. This is the change of mindset, which I think is very important.
Your memoir, I mean, it's quite a departure from the other three books you've written on economics and banking. So was it always on your mind?
It was. No, but you see, writing economics is my mission. Writing this book has been my passion. This is not to say that economics is not my passion, but this is something which came from within. And my father's scribble diaries were there, from which when I wrote the first piece, and it became instant popular, instant bestseller on the first day. In Marathi version of this book, the entire first edition was sold on the first day. This created a history. In 10 years, the book, you know, has gone all over. You know, 40,000-50,000 copies have been sold. It's been translated. Importantly, you know, I learned so much about my own book from other people. For example, my father's crude writings, somebody has discovered that there is a grammar in it. He never went to school, but he discovered that there is a grammar in that, and people have got their MPhil degrees, and a couple of guys have got their PhD degrees working on my book. And my book is a compulsory, Marathi book is a compulsory reading for MA in Marathi literature. Now this is a great thing for a guy who never went to school. A book on him is a compulsory reading for MA in Marathi literature. I think this is tremendous.
Do you have a sort of a figure of inspiration in the genre of Dalit literature? Is there any writer that you admire?
No. I mean, they were all good friends. They are good friends. But I don't emulate anybody. You know, this is something which you don't contrive to write. This is something which is coming out from within. It's crying to come out. And you give it an expression, and that expression that you give depends on your own mental makeup, where you are evolved, developed. And I think as a writer, my job is to just let that thing come out, and it did. And I'm very glad that it was received so well. Now this English version has come out. The French version came out last year. You know, I wrote the English version, rewrote the whole thing from Marathi. Marathi, when I wrote the Marathi version, the social context was implicit. In America, I wrote the English version, rewrote. It's not a translation. It's an expanded version where all the social context has been brought back. So it is a complete book now. Now, it was published in French first. Somebody translated from English to French. And it has done remarkably well in France.
It's going to be translated into Spanish.
Spanish next month, and many other European languages.
Wonderful.
So it is a great feeling. And I cannot tell you how happy I am. In fact, the French government called me thrice to France, and they took me all over the radio and TV and the newspapers. And I could interact with a lot of French people in various places. You know, there was this great literary event in France where 20 writers from India were invited. And we were taken all over, and we interacted with people, the students in the universities, colleges, libraries, bookstores. And it was a wonderful experience. The kind of questions people asked. And I'm very happy to tell you that the National Book Club of France has bought 10,000 copies of this book. So in 8 months, it has sold something like 20,000 copies.
Wonderful.
Not too bad at all.
I feel
very happy about it.
Well, there is this debate that there's this one group of people that believe that the generation of Dalits now, they're getting things too easy, because it's almost like they don't have to work hard because of the reservation in employment and education. What is your opinion on that?
No, I don't agree with that. That's an oversimplification. I don't think it is true. First of all, reservations have not been implemented effectively in different strata of society, in different fields like education, employment, and so on. If you look at the extent of implementation of reservation, I don't think it is satisfactory at all. In fact, you will find that if you look at the government category of class 1, class 2, class 3, and class 4, you will see that reservation is, hardly there. You know, there are hardly anybody in the class 1 and class 2, whereas there is more than 100% reservation in class 4, and therefore the aggregate looks reasonable. But if you go into the details, I think the reservation policy has not been faithfully implemented everywhere. And if you look at it this way, without reservation, look at it this way. Intelligence is something which is randomly distributed, right? So if the system was fair, then roughly speaking, by and large, people would be in various positions in roughly in proportion to their number in the overall system. It's not.
It's still not a level playing field.
No, it is not at all level playing field. There are improvements. Some people from Dalits have got benefit, people like me, and have carved out a life for themselves, and they are on their way. But there is a large backlog where people haven't got that opportunity. What has happened is they have been tested in the sense of they have been given the opportunities to get the education, but it is not fair to say that they have got proportionate reservation in the jobs. And now things are changing with the new economic policy, so we don't know how to go from here.
But would you say that this system of reservation, it has helped in doing away with
certainly.
The...
It has certainly helped. It has certainly helped, because come to think of it, my brothers, me, we would not have got our initial breakthrough but for reservation. This is not to say that because of reservation we are what we are. These are two different things. But to get that opportunity is an important thing, and that whether we wanted it or not, we got it. And like me, there are hundreds of thousands of people who have got it, and some people have been able to change their life. And please understand that when it happens to one single Dalit, you know, it has a huge social multiplier effect, as opposed to the same thing happening to another person who is not coming from the marginalized class. So the social implication has to be also borne in mind.
Well, here's another final question for the economist. Sure. No, the RBI
an
has...
economist, an RBI economist or an economist?
RBI.
Okay. All right.
Well, you've unveiled your new credit policy,
right.
And it's more about continuity, and
right.
There are not too many dramatic changes, but
right.
It's a very optimistic scenario.
Yes,
the GDP growth
right.
is up and inflation
right.
is down.
Right.
So what do you predict for, say, midterm, the next 5 to 10 years?
Well, that is a subject for a big lecture, but I think a more faithful, more realistic implementation of the of reservation is part of it. I think broadly speaking, I think this is very important. This is my view as a person, as an economist, and not as chief economist of the Reserve Bank of India. I happen to think that with the disinvestment privatization program that is going on, very large amount of funds are going to be available with the government, released from the privatization, the sale of government assets in various companies. I think personally, not RBI view, I again want to say this is personal view, I feel that the large amount of money which is being released from privatization should be tied up with social empowerment, particularly of Dalits. So hundreds of thousands of crores of rupees which are going to be available with the government must be tied up for basic social empowerment of Dalits and the poor from the upper caste. This is very important, because if we do not take that precaution, what will happen is this large amount of money would be used for showing the deficit to be less than what it is. And it has to have the social empowerment connection. And that's my strong view.
Thank you for coming.
Thank
Been
you.
A delight talking to you, and thank you for sharing this beautiful story with us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
That was Dr. Narendra Yadav. Thank you for joining us. We're going to come back next week, same time, so do tune in. Until then, goodbye.